Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents All the Windwracked Stars by Elizabeth Baer. Narrated by Kate Redding and Michael Kramer.
1. Esau, Ice. On the last day, he was born white before she burned him. But that wasn't what happened first. Not in the beginning. In the beginning was the end of the world. There was snow at the end of the world, and Casimir was dying in it. Broken wings dragged from his shoulders like defeated banners, disordered feathers hauling crimson streaks through the snow that would not stop falling. The wings were the worst pain, each step grinding bone shards through savaged muscle and lacing his withers with acid ribbons. The worst pain, but not the only. One foreleg wouldn't bear his weight. His harness dragged askew, girth snapped, stirrups banging his ribs as he hobbled in circles, right head hanging, antlers scraping ice and frozen earth and fouling his remaining foreleg. But still he walked, limping in tightening circles, bellying through drifts that rose to his chest, blood freezing bright as hawthorn berries on feathers and hide that faded into the mounting snow. It was cold, and he was dying alone. But somewhere under the snow was Herfjotr, who had been his before she was torn from the saddle. Casimir was a valraven, the war steed of a Valkyra, and they were dead, all dead, every one of them. The Valkyra and the Einharjar, the choosers of the slain and their immortal warriors. They were dead. Herfjotr was dead. It was snowing, and Casimir would not lie down until he found her.
They had sworn to die singing, and they had done it, every one of them. 10,000 taken altogether, Einherjar and Valkyra and the Tarnished, the children of the light and those fallen to the shadow, together again under the falling snow. Every one of them, except for Muire. Now she slogged through thigh-deep snow, returning to the field of battle. She was not dead, though she should have been. She lived because she had fled, because she had broken and run and left her brothers and sisters to fall without her, to fall like stars and die singing, here on this high place with their backs to the ocean and the snow drifting over their corpses. She stumbled past the great slumped shapes of valravens, the smaller hillocks of her brothers and sisters lying tangled in their silver chainmail and their ice-colored swords and their cloaks of midnight blue, spangled with embroidered stars. In death they were anonymous. She could not tell the tarnished from the bright, and she did not pause to uncover their faces. She tried not to see the gaunt black shapes of the Stadown sprawled among them, red tongues lolling in the snow, poison green eyes sunken and lightless. And over all of it the blood, and the ice over that. Muire did not feel the cold. She was a child of the light, of the north, of the ice and the winter, and no cold could touch her. It could not make the bones in her hands ache or numb and gall her feet. It could not crack her lips and pull the moisture from her skin. She was a child of the light, and one of the wardens of Valdyrgard. But now she reached out to that light and touched nothing. No song and no singing, and no power of the massed will of her brothers and sisters. They were gone, and she was the last, limping through snow on a leg scored by the teeth of a Stada that had charged past her to join the pack pulling the war leader apart. Strifebjorn had died there, eaten alive, borne down under a black wave of Stadown, and Muire had lived because she ran. Now she returned. She'd lost her helm somewhere, and her crystal sword Nathar was dark as a splinter of glacier in her hand. Ash-colored plaits hung down her back, like a pair of rope ladders, snow snagging on stray hairs. She saw other braids vanishing under the snow, smooth golden or flaxen ones, without the split ends and sprung bits that always seemed to come of Muira's impatience with the brush. Snow had drifted over most of the blood, but her boots broke through the crust to ink a red trail behind her. She trudged, head down, and when the brief winter light was failing, she found the place that she had fled from. She sheathed her blade and dropped to her knees in the snow, fresh blood oozing from her ragged wound, and there, with bare hands, she began to dig. She found Arngeir first, Burgdis lying half over him, as if their mutual slaughter had been the consummation of an embrace. Menglad Brightwing was cold and quiet beside them, her hand cast over her mouth, palm outward, as if expressing surprise. She lay unmarked, except for the blood of her enemies, victim of a tarnished kiss. And then Wira uncovered Strifebjorn. She hunkered, knees drawn up before her, and bit her fingers and stared, and tried to find the courage to lie down in the snow beside him. He had died bravely, but he hadn't died well. The Staddown had had their way with him, so she would not have known him from his face. But his stature and his silver-white plait told her whose body this was, as did the blade called Alvitar lying unbroken by the remains of his hand. Behind the storm, night was falling. The long, sweet howl of a Stada lifted the hair on her neck, as perfect and mournful as the call of the wolf the monster had once been. Muire pulled her cloak tight to her shoulders and rubbed at icy tears. She could not stay here. She did not have the strength to bury them. They were frozen in the snow, and there were too many. She dared not even sing them to sleep. A raised voice would lead the hunting Staddown to her. It would be a fitting way to die, but she looked on what remained of Strifebjorn and she feared it. And so instead, she reached down deep to where the light should have filled her, where there should have been an answer, the knowledge of what it willed, a swanning. But the light had no counsel. The brilliance that should have blazed from her hands and eyes and open mouth was nothing but a flicker, the last blue flame crawling over spent fuel before the wind unravels it. It was only the ghost of strength dying in Muira's breast. The light did not answer.
Casimir could not find Herfjordr. There were so many under the snow, and the stench of blood and the dead musk of Sedada was everywhere. He nosed aside the vile wolf corpses and swept snow from bodies with his horned head because the antlered one hung dripping blood from chill nostrils. The wind gusted this way and that, twisting his feathers. The night came on, and he, who had never known the cold, felt it leaching into his bones, pooling in his muscles, puddling in the bottoms of his lungs. It was heavy, that cold. Heavy, and it clawed at him with sharper talons than the Staddown. Worlds had ended before. He had heard of the fall of Midgard, beyond a sea of space and time, whence the very oldest of creatures had journeyed. The Grey Wolf, his demon sibling, and the World Serpent, who was called the Dweller Within, and also the Bearer of Burdens. There were many tales, and Casimir had heard them by firesides with his rider, when the Grey Wolf had deigned to speak. But the wolf had done what he had done. Casimir pushed through another drift, breast deep, hooves scrabbling as he floundered. Sometimes his feet struck frozen flesh under the snow, and each time he stopped and uncovered what he found. Cold scents, as good as names and faces in the gathering dark. As the sun fell, it grew more difficult to tell the texture of flesh from that of stone. But he found Rolf and Horsa, and Brunhild, who had been Zachary's rider, and the Valravens Zachary and Rory, more torn than Casimir. Their feathers fluttered like tattered cloth when he swept the snow from their wings. Then he found Olrun, who had been Herfjotr's spear sister, Olrun who had gone to the Tarnished, and whom Casimir had shattered under his flailing hooves there at the end of the world. Wings dragging, he paused to remember who she had been before she had fallen. But only for a moment. Night was falling, and he would find Herfjotr. He would lie down beside Herfjotr, and that would be good. But first he would rest here, only for a moment, he told himself, as his foreleg failed him and he went to his knees, ice and blood crunching under his settling weight. Or maybe he would just lie down here, beside Olrun. He had missed her after she had tarnished, and surely Herfjotr would not wish her left alone. Surely she would forgive him. It was, in the end, only one more tiny failure. He let his muzzle rest in the snow. He let his ears sag forward. He would only rest a little. A sadada howled. Kazimir, struggling to lift his head, saw a torn light flicker through the snow, and neighed with renewed desperation.
Muire found her feet, pushing against the unaccustomed pain of stiffened joints and the insulted, frozen muscle of her thigh. She grunted and staggered and caught herself with a wince. The night seemed darker than it should, so Muire knew her Valkyra's eyesight was also deserting her. But the cry was repeated, a frail, frantic neigh, and she unslung Nathar from her shoulders and used the scabbarded blade as a crutch. Undignified, and the sword deserved better, but Muira's only other choice was to cast her aside, and she had not yet fallen so low. She comforted herself that even the tarnished had kept their blades, though the act profaned them. He called again before she found him. Herfjotr's stallion waited with a sagging head, wings draggled like a dying falcon's, the other neck broken and twisted sideways, on his knees in the snow. He snorted, waffling like a stabled horse when she came into sight, and even through the darkness Muire could see enough to be cruelly glad she'd kept her sword. He would need its mercy. "Bright one," she breathed, not daring to reach out and touch his neck. He made the connection for her, nosing her chest hard enough to nearly knock her off her feet. She gasped when her weight rocked onto her injured leg, and she caught one spiraled horn to steady herself. He froze, as white and still as the white drifts around him, and let her cling. And then, in a deep and sonorous voice that would have resonated through her chest if it had been spoken aloud, he said, "Alive? Alive how?" She let his horn go as if scorched. His great brown eyes were soft and living, but she could see the broken bones jagged through the flesh of his wings, the twisted back-bent leg. "Cowardice," she said, and leaned on her sword crutch a moment before she could force the next words out. "I ran." He turned his head to center her in one eye's vision. "The light?" "No more," she answered. She braced herself on her one good leg and raised her sword, her hand clutching the scabbard below the crosspiece. "Bright one." She did not know his name. None but a Valraven's rider knew his name. "I cannot heal you." She could not even heal herself. Only hours ago it would have been no more than the matter of a thought. Only hours. "Live," the stallion said, unflinching, and Muire stopped with her blade half skinned from her scabbard. "We can't," she said, as an edgy grieving howl drifted to her. She swallowed, and it felt as if the crunching ice cut her tender throat from the inside. She finished sliding Nathar's dark blade into her hand. Ingrained habit made her work the sheath back through her baldric, where it banged her spine when her cloak lifted on the wind. The blood on her tongue when she bit her cheek brought some measure of courage. Somewhere out in the darkness, the Stadown hunted, and Muire jerked her chin. "I will be quicker than they." The stallion surged up in the snow. "Live," he demanded, his wings flopping with the sickening violence of landed fishes. Muire fell back, waving her blade well clear, and sprawled in the snow. It crushed down her collar and under her mail shirt, chilling her flesh, another unpleasant, unfamiliar sensation. "Live," he said again, more softly, as she held the sword foolishly up out of the snow, struggling on her wounded leg. She floundered until the stallion extended his head again, offering his mane for a handle, and then she managed to haul herself up. She leaned against him, gasping, his warmth transmitted through her tunic and chin. Live. One more time, and this time no more than a meditative murmur. She stroked his blood-iced forelock from his eyes in time to feel him flinch from another howl, an answering one. She sighed. If only she'd had the sense to stand and die earlier, this would have been over now. But the stallion, she thought. The stallion would be alone. Perhaps she could make some sort of amends by standing with him. As well now, here with you, as later, otherwise. She whipped her blade on long, twinned curves and put her back to the stallion's worse-injured shoulder. He whickered again, ears up, half-braced on a leg that would not hold him, and mantled her with shattered wings, so her flank was covered. No such courage in all the world, she thought, and the staddown came upon them. It was a small pack, only four, and not the dozen it had taken to pull down Strifebjorn. When they ventured close enough, she saw how their rib cages protruded, how their backbones and tails were knobby and spined. Great splayed paws held them lightly on the snow, and their red maws dripped slaver. Once she would have met them singing. Now it was grim fury, ice and blood, and her own silence, and the silence of the beasts. The staddown hunted like the wolves they had once been, feints and distractions. But they were dead already, and the only way to destroy them was to destroy their hearts. At first, they circled. Wise monsters, they knew that the Valraven and Valkyra were wounded, that the snow and the cold collected a toll that could not be replenished. Two fainted at the crippled stallion's haunches, and Muire surprised herself, half scrambling and half sliding over the broken wing to meet them, her sword outreached as she lunged. She pricked one through the throat, but it dragged itself off the blade and retreated. Through what will she did not know, the Valraven found the strength to kick out, sending the other Stada tumbling. A living wolf would have yelped, rolled to its feet, and circled limping. The Stada rose and circled, certainly, but it did it in bitter silence, head sunk between jutting shoulders. Muire prayed and went unanswered, and as if they slipped over greased ice, the Stada struck again. She stepped into it, thrusting, and staggered with the shock as the Stada impaled itself on her blade. The second one, the one she had earlier wounded, hurled itself out of darkness at her throat. She shied back, clinging to Nathar's hilt, and got her arm up as she whipsawed sideways. The first Stada's rib cage offered grating resistance to the blade, the vile wolf thrashing until it slumped suddenly, its heart bisected. Through the hot sting of teeth meeting in the muscle of her offside arm, she barely noticed. The weight struck her shoulder and chest, and she staggered, thumping solidly into the stallion's haunches. Her blade, knocked free of the broken Stada, swung wildly, the ridged brass and iron hilt twisted unready in her hand. The stallion snorted and stood firm, supporting her, while the Stada gnawed and thrashed. It felt hideous. Not hide and hair, but warm, soft slickness, shadows wrinkled and slippery over the skinned flesh beneath. It had no breath. It pressed her forearm against her throat, teeth grinding into bone, the pain eye-watering. But the warm hide against her shoulders heaved and surged over living muscle, and she heard the stallion's labored breathing, the sick kitchen sound of ripping flesh. Her own blood wet her face, her feet slipping as she floundered in deep snow. Casimir surged and snorted, something crunching under his teeth and hooves. She let the Stada shove her back against the stallion and struggled to right her sword. No blade for a mighty thewed warrior, Nathar, but a light, quick sword, still long enough that little Muire had to wear it slung between her shoulders rather than at her hip. She was the least of her sisters, small and quiet, a sparrow among falcons. She still could wield her sword. Her fingers tightened, the blade's weight pushing her arm down. The Stada scrabbled against her, smelling faintly of loam and rotten meat, dead green eyes glowing behind clouded corneas like a sun behind mist. Its silence offended her. She grunted as its skull slammed into her face and hammered its head with her pommel. The teeth loosened incrementally. A dam burst. Muira shouted, slammed the beast again, let the stallion support her weight as she leaned back and kicked the vile wolf in the ribs. Her flesh tore under its teeth, nauseating bursts of agony with every blow she delivered. She hit it again, gasping names, prayers, "All Father, Bright Mother," and knocked it back, struck it free. She found a breath as it rolled in the snow, tumbled to its feet, crouched and snarled silently. "Fine," she thought. "Die in silence, not me." She found another breath and her defiance, and she sang. "Let it bring down every stada left on the battlefield. Let them come." She had the stallion at her back, and blood trickling from her split lip and broken nose, blood flowing from her savaged forearm. She had death in her right hand and death in her heart. Let them come. She would welcome them. She waded forward, the snow numbing her wounded thigh, and swung her ink-black blade, singing between ragged breaths, gasping the words over a broken melody. And Nathar flared blue-white in her hand, bright as a full moon on snow, streaking the drifts with hard-edged, deceptive shadows you could fall into, you could cut yourself on. Muira flinched from the light. She raised her right hand as if to shield her eyes, angling the blade down. The stada leaped, thinking her dazzled, and she cut it from the air. Nathar went through it, scattering flesh and shadows and bits of bone, leaving Muira staring at her hand and the undimmed blade as if they were a stranger's. Muira heard the stallion grunt, felt him lunge forward, uncoiling off powerful haunches. She turned in time to see him catch the fourth vile wolf by the throat and shake it like a ratting dog shakes vermin. Bones snapped, but it still moved, sickly, brokenly. He dropped it to the ground and began tearing out chunks with his teeth. She stepped forward, around the dragging wing, and finished it with a thrust. Like a clockwork unwound, she paused there, her blade still transfixing the stada, her head bowed, plaits and cloak whipping forward as the wind veered behind her. Something stroked her cheek, a tear already freezing, her cold fingers numbed on Nathar's hilt. The stallion nudged her hard with his muzzle and fell back into the snow with a thump. Muira turned, startled, but there was nothing behind her but the wind. She stood for a moment, tottering, her blade gleaming as bright in her hand as if all her brothers and sisters stood beside her. For a brief cleansing moment, she felt the snow in her hair, the presence of the children beside her. And then there was nothing. She opened her eyes on emptiness, on blowing snow, on the already drifted corpses of the stadown that she and the dying stallion had killed. Two for her, one for him, that last one together. And shook her head.
"Wait with me," the stallion said.
It was not so much words as a terrible ache in her breast. She turned, plowed three steps toward him, and propped her sword against her hip while she fought with the bosses of his harness. The cold of the metal went right to the bone, aching, but she struggled frozen leather through stiff buckles and shoved the ruined saddle off his back. There was a corpse in the snow a few steps away. Ulrun, tarnished, who had loved swans, and the hall's lean, brindled wolfhounds, dead, and neither an ally nor an enemy any longer. She'd fallen half-wrapped in a tattered banner. Muira dragged the saddle over beside her, covering her with the blood-stained leather and the blanket, a crude sort of crypt. And then Muira sat down in the crimson snow beside the stallion. She leaned against his shoulder and laid her shining naked blade across her knees. And he in return draped his unbroken chest over her shoulder, his muzzle pressed to her armored chest. She hooked her arm up and reached around, under his throttle, to scratch behind his opposite ear.
Frozen blood flaked from his mane. "I've nowhere else to be," she answered, and tilted her temple against his silken velvet cheek. Sometime in the night, the snow stopped falling.
Casimir was not dead by morning, and neither was the Valkyra. Her oozing wounds sealed, then stopped, the blood freezing or scabbing over them. She breathed against his cheek, her eyes closed, her heart slowing. Was this sleep? Casimir knew mortals slept, but the Children of the Light did not. Not unless they were more gravely wounded than his new Valkyra. He considered that thought. His. He did not have to take her. There was no law or rule that demanded he do so. He was Valraven, and the choice was his. He knew this one. Her name was Muire. She was the littlest of all Light's children, a poet and a historian, and a metalworker rather than a warrior. She had loved Strifebjorn, the war leader, and the war leader had been gentle with her, but he had not returned her love. Strifebjorn's heart, as Casimir knew, as all the Valraven knew and never mentioned, had already been given. She had been very brave, his Valkyra. He nudged her with his muzzle to wake her, and she blinked and raised her head. "Casimir," he whispered. At first, she didn't understand. She scrambled to her feet, limping a little less, not healing like a Valkyra, but healing. Her sword in her hand, she scanned the brightening horizon for some threat. There was nothing. The sky arched enamel blue, the edge of the cliff where the Children of the Light had turned at bay, visible as a ragged line of white against the steelier blue of the sea far below. "Casimir," he said again, insistently. Slowly she turned and stared at him. She panted, pain etching shadows under gray eyes that gleamed dimly with starlight for a moment before flickering dark. He stared back until she lowered the blade and straightened, pressing the flat across her thighs. "You don't have to do that. I will stay with you." He let his muzzle drop into the snow. "Live," he said. He felt the raw desire in her as well, chafing at her resignation, her cold certainty that she had betrayed the Light as surely as the Tarnished and deserved nothing. "I cannot," she said. And then she looked down at the sword in her hands, the sword that still blazed blue-white, dimmer now in daylight, but unmistakable. "Maybe I can." "The dweller within never came to our aid," Casimir said, lifting his head as if he could see more of the ocean. "The serpent is not dead, but lies dying. That is why there is no light for you to call on. No light but your own."
"Oh,"
his Valkyra said, without looking up from her sword. And then she stared at him, her irises transparent pewter, the glow of the rising sun refracted through them behind ash-pale lashes, and he saw her throat work above the collar of her mail. She rustled softly, rings chiming on iron rings, as she squared her shoulders.
"I could ask for a miracle. I don't even know if it will work, if the serpent is dying. But I could ask."
Casimir paused. There was no promise such a call would be answered, no reason to believe that the outcome would be an improvement if it was. Miracles happened or they did not, and were wonderful or awful or both, without logic or rhythm. He could find himself healed, remade, destroyed, or ignored as they had been ignored as they fell to the Tarnished and the Sadadown. "Ask," he said. The Valkyra turned her face aside, her knuckles pale on the hilt of her sword, and closed her dark gray eyes. The earth heaved under the snowdrifts. The Valkyra lost her footing and pitched backward into the snow a second time, her flailing arms carving angel wings in the white drift behind her. All around Casimir, the surface cracked like the crust of an oven-risen loaf. The frozen ground softened beneath him. He thrashed, whinnying, dragging himself to his feet, tossing his antelope-horned head, dragging the antlered one, but the earth bucked again and heaved him to his knees. He could not stay down. Even a winged horse is terrified of unstable ground, and Casimir's wings were shredded hobbles. His Valkyra scrambled backward, regaining her feet none too nimbly, and the earth split wide as the snow around Casimir's hooves vanished in rushing hiss. Steam billowed around him, searing, bellying from deep below. "Stand, Casimir." It might have been Herfjotr's voice. He couldn't know over the roaring and the hiss, but he was sure it was not Muire's. What mattered was that it was a voice he trusted. He locked his three good legs and his broken one, bone grinding, rasping under his weight. He lifted his head and stood his ground, and did not shy as metal oozed glowing from the steaming cracks. He did not shy, but he screamed and kept on screaming.
Muire could not go to him. She had been Valkyra, and fire no more a threat to her than ice. She had been a smith, able to scoop metal from the crucible with her bare hand and pour it palm to palm like mercury. And when the earth yawned open and the white-hot iron smoked through the snow, she could not walk through the fire to Casimir. More cowardice. But at least she would not close her eyes. He screamed while the metal crawled over him, fingerling rivulets broadening into a red-hot weld. It was like mercury, like a gold ring dipped in mercury, the quicksilver bonding to the surface. Yet this was no cold quicksilver, but molten metal rising from the belly of the land in response to Muira's ill-considered prayer. "All Father, have mercy." But mercy in the end of things was not what Othin was for. Not the god who had hung on the world tree for 9 nights and 9 days, who had sold his eye for power. And anyway, he had been left behind in Midgard. He had promised he would follow, that he would come to lead them in the new world, but he had not. And they had proven decisively, Muire thought, that they could not do it alone.
Somehow, through it all, the stallion stood. And when it was done, he shone. Impassive now, he straightened slowly. Both heads on their long necks turned to regard Muire, white rings already fading around living brown eyes in sculptured faces. His new skin cooled, his new bones hardened, and his bright steel-blue wings opened and flexed, feather-perfect. The soft whisper of tiny interlocking barbs on the pinions was like a declaration of war. Steam hissed under pressure as he moved. He shook out his mane, and each hair of it was a single gleaming wire. The snow sublimated under his footsteps as he came to Muire. He nosed her chainmail-covered breast, not hard, and she gasped at the startling heat. The earth smoldered under his footsteps. She laid her hand flat against his cheek and jerked it away in a moment, scalded. "What are you?"
"Casimir," he answered. "Metal and meat, sorcery and steel."
"What are you?" she asked again. His eyes were warm and soft.
"I am war."
"No," she choked, before her voice failed. The world was new and empty, changed from the world it had been at the sunset, and the Valraven had changed with it. And Muire would not change, did not wish to change.
"What have you become?"
She reached out, but snatched back scorched fingers.
"You are the future."
"I am the world, what the world will need, and what the world will be." She turned her head, finally allowing herself to look away.
"Why did you tell me your name? I am not worthy of you."
I would not choose one unworthy.
I fled.
He graced her with the steady regard of four patient eyes, and she could not lift her chin to meet it.
I fled the Sadadown and the Tarnished, and I hid while our brethren died.
Heat rolled from him, the heat of the forge, the heat of a summer's day, a physical pressure. Her torn arm ached. It was bleeding again. Her thigh felt like knotted and dried rawhide.
I am a coward. I will bring you pain.
What pain could equal the pain of creation? The antlered head ducked with a hiss of hydraulics. He folded his remade wings neatly and began to vaporize the snow about his hooves with short, sharp nudges of his muzzle, shyly, and so like any horse.
Casimir,
she said softly, just to taste it once, to taste the wonder of his offer.
You said it yourself. The dweller within is no more. The light has failed.
The dweller within still lingers. We are the light that remains. She could not answer. He had not broken and run.
No, she said. Oh, no.
And while she still could, she took the first step away. His wings rattled and rustled. You will come back to me. I am Casimir. I am the new age of the world. When you name me, I shall come. With a masterful leap, he was airborne and gone. The splayed feathers of his wingtips wrote a benediction on the snow, and she was blessedly, terribly, finally alone.
She lived because she fled. He lived because she did not let him die. I would not choose one unworthy. When he was gone, when her tears were mastered, Muire began to gather the bodies and build over them a cairn. There would be no second miracle. She asked and was not answered, as she would ask and go unanswered for centuries to come. Her hands cracked and chapped and swelled with chilblains. Her nose dripped blood and snot. She grew thin. She grew weary. She grew, as she had never before been, hungry. There were only a few brothers and sisters missing, all tarnished, and when she had finished with the dead atop the sea cliff, she scoured the rubble at the base for those that might have fallen. She found her brother Halfgrim there, broken on the rocks, gored by a valraven's antlers. And there she found also the sword Svanvitr, but no sign of the grey wolf, its master.
1,000 years is a long time to go hungry. The grey wolf wears a sun burning under his heart. A gnawed cord cuts his throat with every breath. He has devoured gods and outlasted the endless snow. He has thrown away his sword. He has eaten everything he ever loved. He is immortal and alone. He is walking south to a sword age, a storm age. He is the wolf until world's end. Any day now. 2. Thorisaz, Thorns. And so 2,300 years pass. Days wear into centuries, but the hunger grows no easier for all that. No easier, but at least no worse. And the world, well, the world winds down only ponderously. But every pendulum slows. Since the breaking of the light, the wolf has been listening to the ticking decay. Worlds, like gods, are a long time dying, and the death blow dealt the children of the light did not stop a civilization of mortal men from rising in their place, inventing medicine and philosophy, metallurgy and spaceflight. Until they in turn fell, 200-odd years ago, in a desolation that left all Valdyrgard a salted garden. All of it, that is, except the two cities, Freymark and Eiladon, that lingered. Life is tenacious. Even on the brink of death, it holds the battlements and snarls. But now Freymark, where the wolf has whiled away the end of time, has fallen, and even Eiladon is falling. Now the heart of the world skips, erratic, and the pauses between beats grow long. And as the wolf hesitates in the cold between shadows, the place that smells of char and ice, and where the sun has never in his memory risen to warm the creaking frost beneath his boots, he hears that rhythm now, the ragged tolling of a stately bell. He smiles and keeps walking. Once he traversed earthly forests amid the crack of twigs and the rich scent of pine needles. He ran beside his companions of the hunt, wolves and Einharjar. He drank in the mead hall with his shield brother Strifebjorn. Now he is more often to be found in the icy world, Midgard. Or rather, its chilled remains, colder now in its final winter even than Niflheim, than Valdyrgard, the living one. Or to choose his language more precisely, the dying one. Travel is nearly impossible in Valdyrgard now. The roads non-existent, the conveyances destroyed, the few remaining mortals huddled into one decaying city. But the wolf has his shadowy paths, and they serve him. The heart tolls again. The wolf pauses, tilts his head to savor the dying fall. He lifts his face, eyes closed, as if he scented the wind. But the air here is cold and still. His cloak and queue hang unstirring against his shoulders. The last day was nothing, meant nothing. It has become myth only, as Midgard had been myth to the children of the light. Valkyra and Einharjar were barely legends now, and human society had flourished very well, had blossomed without them. Blossomed, and then fallen like the rose to the canker, rotten, slimed, and dead. They did it themselves, the desolation, created it with their bioweapons and their radiation bombs, with their Shoggoth main battle groups and their killer robots, and their orbital microwave projectors, their mass projectors and combat sorcerers and laser-guided death curses. Over 2 centuries past, the fatal bullet. Worlds are a long time dying, it's true, but the wolf is old and patient, and soon there will be peace, the peace he's sought since first he betrayed Strifebjorn. For now, however, he's drawn from his still silent refuge, from just dead Freymark and long dead Midgard, and back to dying Valdyrgard. With a task. So he paces through shadows in the cold world, alone in the dark and fearless, until he comes to Eiladon. He quells his urgency under patience. He is the wolf, the last remaining. He has already waited a long time to see men die. Eiladon is not as it once was. From the shadows peering from the cracks between that world and this one, he sets out to learn the place again. Eiladon grows around a curve of the broad brown tidal river Naglfar, a dark glittering city that once was bright and fair. It was a great port when there were ships and destinations. Now the river is dead and empty, its chop capped with poisoned foam. Sometimes it burns, and the levees and riverwalks that channeled it and made it pleasant once are a soot-stained firebreak now. Eiladon is an ancient city, a medieval city, a modern city. She wears a dark girdle of ruins. When first he saw this place, it was a city on the south of the river only, hemmed by its walls, well defended. Then she made an uneven enclosure, the river running through chained gates and portcullises, into a bailey pierced by 8 strong gates. Still later, before the desolation, she sprawled far beyond her medieval walls, which were kept intact merely for the sake of history. Now she has contracted again, and her desperate 6 million live crammed within the gold-green shimmer of the defile, the Technomancer's guardian wards, which only extends so far as the ancient bulwarks of hand-quarried stone. Eladon is bejeweled in its towers and arcologies, glass and steel and chrome, elegant masterpieces of architecture and technomancy. There are citizens who never leave these hothouse spires. Along the riverfront, buildings are older, solid stone and brick, bristling with gargoyles and fantastic with murals and relief carvings and stained glass. But that is not all. Between the riverfront neighborhoods and the central city, in the shadow of the tallest towers, hangs a great rough-bellied hemisphere, a floating promontory 20 stories above the ground. The river runs through it, climbing the sky and then tumbling down again as if its channel lay undisturbed. That floating island is a university campus, ripped from the earth and hurled aloft, a gesture of flagrant power and defiance made by the immortal Technomancer when she seized control of the city from its thing more than 200 years before. Its shadow is the shadow of the desolation, an endless reminder of the genocidal war that Eladon fought and survived. At the time, the citizens were disinclined to complain. Eladon blessed its savior's name, and rare, precious children are still named after her. Thierry Thorvald's daughter, the Technomancer of Eladon. Eladon's inhabitants call her home the Tower, though it is 10 or 11 buildings rather than one. Classes, in a particularly Eladane madness, still take place there. The floating bastion is a functioning university. But it is also the Technomancer's holdfast. She dwells there, far above the city she still protects, amid her true man students and her unmanned servitors. In the shadow of the Technomancer's tower, in the twilight where it never rains, lie the slums. And that is where the wolf travels. Something he left behind has been taken up again. Something he once owned has been stolen. He is the wolf, and he is Einharjar no longer. He does not want it back, but neither will he suffer another to misuse it, especially when that ancient magic might strengthen the world's limping heartbeat, buy it a few more years, centuries, millennia of life. It is time, a wolf age, a wind age. Following a voice that sings only for his ears, the wolf steps from the cold emptiness of a dead world into the bustling street of one that is merely dying fast. He has outlived 2 Ragnaroks and a far more human apocalypse. It is time to tear down, shed the husk, leave behind a dead world to see a new world reborn. Kay here got these feelings sometimes, and he was having one right now. Specifically, the prickle across his shoulders and up under his hair that had nothing to do with the ring sweat drying on his scalp in the cool night air. He reached up left-handed because his range of motion wasn't as good on the right, and tugged the thong out of his ponytail as he stepped down out of the kickboxing ring onto the crowded floor of the Ash and Thorn. Astrid was there, her black hair falling in a wrist-thick braid over her shoulder, smiling under her twice-broken nose. She could never keep her guard up. She threw his robe over his shoulders and handed him a towel. "You did good, Kehi," she said. "Real good." Kehir dropped his skull back on his shoulders and breathed deep. Rolling his head from side to side gave him an excuse to scan the crowd, looking for the source of that uneasy prickle. Right now, most of them were talking, eating, slurping drinks, placing bets on the next match. Once he'd dropped down to floor level and Hrolfgar had limped out of the backside of the ring, The applause, and whatever attention Kay here rated, had stopped. But the prickling sensation hadn't, and when he turned, he saw why. It wasn't the three women and a man who were eyeing him with the sort of sidelong appreciation he was used to, the admiration that told him they were nerving themselves toward the eventual offer of a drink in the hope or expectation of more. No, it was the second man, neither tall nor heavy-boned, sitting with his back to the wall in a shadowed corner behind the ring, out of traffic and away from the dance floor. Cahir had seen the man before, occasionally, on nights when he was fighting or covering for Ethelred behind the bar. He mopped his face with the cold towel that Astrid handed him and stole another glance. A craggy, almost ragged face, made more stern by silver-shot dark hair pulled back in a warrior's braid, bound by silver clasps and hanging long over the man's shoulder. His eyes seemed light under graying brows, his left ear pierced at the lobe by a heavy twisted ring in the old style. His clothes were invisible under a cloak he wore, clasped with heavy silver brooches at the right shoulder. And he was looking directly at Cahir, as boldly as if he did not expect to be seen. Cahir had never been one to back down from a challenge. He dropped the damp towel back in Astrid's hand and lifted his chin, staring the old man directly in the eyes. He wasn't expecting the watcher to meet him with a close-lipped smile and a shrug that disarrayed his cloak only slightly, or the toast of a drinking bowl carved from what looked like horn, but couldn't be. Nobody would bring a precious antique to a public bar where it could be broken or stolen. "Star, do you know that guy?" Cahir asked, ducking his head to whisper in Astrid's ear. She was a big girl, rangy, heavy-boned and heavy-muscled, but he topped her by half a head. She turned and kissed him a quick peck so as not to spoil his chances with the clientele later, and said, "Guy? At table 20. She glanced over her shoulder as if checking the ring and shrugged. "Nobody there now." Cahir lifted his head and blinked. The table was empty, the horn bowl gone, along with the silver-brindled occupant. All that remained was the candle foe and a crumpled note trapped under it, 10 kroner in the technomancer's scrip by the collar. "Huh," Cahir said. "I wonder where he went." "He'll be back if he's interested," Astrid said. She dabbed at a bruise on Cahir's sweaty shoulder. "Come on, let's get you into the sauna and cleaned up so you can mingle."
Blood would have been easier. If the cobbles had been sticky under Muira's boots, if the blood had runneled between stones and flooded the rain-damp dead-end square between Ark and the well, it would have been simple. She would have dropped a knee beside the man slumped along the blind, truncated stair that had once led to the university, and she would have tried to breathe for him as long as his heart fought to help her. And when his heart stammered and failed, she would have stood in her blood-daubed armor and made her own way home. But there was no blood upon the stones, and the man was still breathing. Faintly, shallowly, not a mark on him. Surrounded by the lingering traces of bitter, predatory musk. Muira knelt. Her ancient sword hung heavy between her shoulders, and her ceramic armor clicked against the stone steps. Cowled in a cloak of midnight blue, she bent over the dying man. And there could be no question that he was dying. His last few breaths came shallow, and his lids fluttered over closed and sunken eyes. There was not a mark on him. Muira touched his cheek with a gauntleted hand and closed her eyes, knowing the chill that radiated from his skin before she ever properly felt it. She bent over and breathed for him, knowing it was useless, making the gesture all the same. He was expensively dressed, too much so for the well, and neither like a student nor a lecturer, which meant that he must have come from the Ark, the Arcologies, the hermetically sealed habitations immediately east of the broken stair. He was unarmed, and he had rings on his fingers, and he didn't look like much of a warrior,
with his neatly trimmed hair and his clerk's embroidered robes, his calm clipped, silenced, to his belt, along with the other paraphernalia of a white-collar job. A palm-top parser, an audio-vid privacy headset folded into compact form and beaded with droplets that had to be rain. He lay close enough to the falls to hear them, but not within the drift of their poisoned mist. His skin was unspotted by radiation or disease, and he showed not so much as a bruise. But a scent hung on him like cold moss on stone, and his skin felt chill. And he was dying, without any good reason for it, despite anything Muire could have done to save him. It spoke of something she had thought left behind on a cold battlefield more than 2,000 years before. Muire took his hand in her gauntleted one and murmured, "Don't be afraid." When his last breath rattled from his throat, rather than pulling away, as prudence suggested, she permitted it to expire into her mouth and breathed it deep. So he died there on the broken stair, and the last Valkyra chose him. And in the choosing she accepted his death and accepted as well the burden of vengeance that death brought. "Our name was Ingraham Fasseltsen. We were walking, we had been walking, and we had made a delivery for our employer, and the Moreau, a cat, an unmanned female, her fur smoky grey in rosettes, had been there as arranged. We had been walking home, home to our daughter, precious child, little girl, 8 years old, home to our wife, we are fortunate, and we had heard our name. Softly spoken, and we had turned to it, and he was there, burning beautiful in all his darkness, eyes alight with the star fire that cannot shine through the defile, that we know only from old songs, old memories, old dreams, old long-lost dreams. Oh, he was beautiful, there in the shadows beside the descending stair, the new stair, the stair that leads down where the broken stair once led, upward. The stair that leads into the well, the dark neighborhoods under the tower. Beautiful and ragged, broken as an ancient statue, his braid grizzled over his shoulder and his eyes dark as ice. And we had gone to him, and he had guided us to our knees, and with the folds of his cloak falling all around us, heavy, soft, strange, and faintly greasy smelling, like real wool, perhaps, if wool could still be had. Within the folds of his cloak he had kissed us. Kissed us and breathed us in, within. Kissed us and drank us down. Ingraham's hands slid from Weira's armored shoulders to fall slack on the riven stone. She tilted her head back reflexively, drinking deep of night air tainted by the unwholesome sweetness of the well, looking upward as if the stars were there to help her bear the pain. There were no stars. Through the glassy brilliance of the defile and the shadows of the rain clouds, she could not even make out the glow of the moon. It hurt. The death hurt. Even a little death, a mortal death such as this, brought its own measure of pain. It settled into her flesh, mere meat and bone now, no longer the numinous stuff of light, and sank deep talons in her, demanding justice, demanding vengeance. She didn't care about the pain. She welcomed the wrath the dead man brought. She would need his strength as surely as he would need her sword to see this matter through. Irenbend, her favorite brother, had said it to her once. "There are seen hands and unseen hands. I am an angel. We do not believe in coincidences." This was a seen and an unseen hand at once, the one that had wreaked the deed, and the one that had directed her in its discovery. The tarnished had returned. 3. Hagalaz, Hail. The walls of her office were cinderblock and limpid, shatterproof, offering a panoramic view of Eilidan's rooftops and towers.
Not the loft of the arcology, strangely, but the jeweled teeth of the old city and the thick bend of river southwest of the tower. The enormous room, almost the entire top floor of the library, was dominated by a giant orrery encased within moving crystal spheres. The furniture, while comfortable, was relegated to the edges. Celine, waiting upon her attention, stared through the tall glass plates, tail lashing, ears still laid flat, and willed herself to calm. Fear and fight were not her friends. They were the animal, the instinct that made her a superlative warrior. But the threat had been left behind on the ground, and Celine was in the tower, in her presence, safe. The broad windows were new since the desolation, giving Eilidon's savior, leader, teacher, a sweeping view of her domain and the defile, but the marble floor was original to the university. Once it had been smooth, close-fitted, and the cool blocks were still so tight one could not slip a card between them. But the stone had been worn in intervening centuries, and there were little hollows and valleys that showed where feet had trod those hundreds of years away. She sat in her habitual chair, no ostentatious throne, but the functional workstation of mesh and padding she used when she was not a foot on two crutches, or in her hover chair, and stared over her city. Celine knew that she was waiting for Celine to regain control, to find her center. She was gracious. Finally, she lifted a hand and beckoned. She wore two thick, mismatched sweaters over her red-brown scholar's robes, the gray and taupe cuffs rolled up around her bony wrists. She'd let her hood fall onto her shoulders, revealing her cropped gray hair, and the pinched marks of her spectacles remained on the bridge of her nose. Celine stepped forward, tail still twisting, and bowed before her chair. Her hackles bristled, her fur damp from the drizzle, but standing all on end under the farmed leather straps and ceramic plates of her body armor. But she forced herself to calmness as she extended the package in her hand. It was long, bound with wire over a stiff cloth wrapping, and it left a chill, buzzing sensation climbing the bones of Celine's forearm. She groped for one of her crutches, rose from her chair with an effort, and came before Celine. "Good girl," she said softly, slipping the bundle from Celine's clawed hand and tucking it under her arm for safekeeping. Celine kept her talons sheathed in the soft flesh of her fingertips throughout, breathing deeply, her whiskers smoothed flat against her muzzle, and her toenails pressing slight scratches into the hard marble floor when she couldn't quite manage to gentle them. Celine smelled old woman's flesh, acrid electronics and constancy, and it helped drive the dangerous musk from her nostrils. She stroked Celine's ears with a palsied hand and stepped back, but not before her touch and scent had soothed the Moreau.
"Why so upset, Celine?"
"I smelled something," Celine reported. "Something in the dark, under the well. Musky. Hunting."
"A rogue?" she asked sharply.
She was not angry with Celine. She never raised her voice to her unmans. She never had to. The Moreau were perfectly obedient to her will, and they would die before they failed. Since she herself had constructed them, the only blame for their occasional shortcomings fell on the wizard herself. She was a just and a forgiving creator god. But sometimes, rarely, a Moreau would grow strange, go feral, fail to return. Rogues were dangerous to unmans, truemans, halfmans, and nearmans. She did not tolerate them, and Celine would not tolerate them on her behalf. Celine was very skilled at her tasks. "I do not think it was a rogue," she said carefully. Her words came sweetly despite needle-sharp teeth, rolling trippingly from a rasp-sharp tongue. "A predator. It smelled not like one of us, though I saw nothing when I met Fasseltson."
"And you did not touch the weapon?"
She lifted the slender bundle in her hand. It was long as Celine's leg from hip to ankle.
long as her lashing tail. Celine rocked her head side to side, an awkward counterfeit of a human shake. The wrappings were intact.
Excellent, she said,
and spared Celine a smile full of an old woman's crooked yellow teeth.
Go, pretty girl. Rest until morning. You have pleased me.
Celine could not smile. She hadn't the muscles for it. But turning to go, she felt the warmth of her approval run down her spine like the stroke of a velvet glove, and stood straighter under her weapons and armor as she strode away. Muire stood in the ruined square and wiped her hands on her cloak, though nothing stained them. It was dark here, in the shadow of the tower, dark and chill. This was the truncated end of the boulevard, the mile-diameter near-geometric ring road that circumscribed the places where honest folk traveled in Eilidon. Anything beyond its compass was as likely to be lawless as not. It all depended on the character of one's neighbors. Where the road was broken, its edges had cracked and melted where the Technomancer had pulled her tower from the earth, interrupting its symmetry. A dark undercity had grown beneath that tower in the intervening centuries. Shielded from the weather, from the sun's unfiltered radiation, the well cradled Eilidon's more dangerous neighborhoods, and also her better bars, in an improvised arcology, neither as protected nor as pretty as the sunlit ones. There in the depths, one could find blood sport, sex for hire, specks and killers, and also real live music for a change. The scent that hung about the dead man's body led Muire down the newer stair, the unbroken one. She descended into the well, where the light trickled from colored floods, tethered floats, and garish signs, and even the green-gold aurora of the defile was obscured. She paused at the halfway point of the stair, her gauntlet scraping on the improvised pipe railing, the stone steps gritty under her boots. Below, a moderate stream of people moved along the beneond street in seasonless darkness. The atmosphere never brightened here, though in the daytime it would gray, sunlight reflected in by systems of mirrors. The lights were never doused, however. The denizens of the well were far more colorful than the Trumans who lived above, in Riverside and the Ark, or near Muira's loft and workshop on the long side of downtown, near Dockside and Hangman. The buildings were less makeshift than one might expect. Eilidon had been jammed to bursting with engineers and tradespeople, and the suburbs offered rich scavenging. Buildings of 4 and 5 stories were not uncommon. The narrow, haphazard streets between them coursed with men and women and the undecided, Truman and Nearman and Halfman and Unman, sorceress and cybernetic and between and neither. The tide of humanity drew Muire like the pulse of the ocean in her blood, the dark, starlit ocean that had brought forth her kind. The light had failed, and with it its children. But these other children, mortal children, candle flickers, continued, endlessly fighting and dying and returning their blood to the wash of the sorrowful sea. The mortals had a saying that blood was thicker than water. But to Muire, blood was water, the water of the ocean, and the force of the light upon it. She descended the last few stairs and dropped into the current, following the paling scent trace of cloak and boot caressing stone, whistling a half-heard melody that lit the killer's footsteps for her eyes alone, so they stood out in the darkness, as if brushed with phosphorescent dust. Her gesh, the ghost-hungry memory of Ingraham Fasseltson, drove her. Vengeance, he murmured, half-heard in her ear. Justice. And over a father's sea-worn murmur that she could do nothing about at all. I cannot leave my child. Music sloshed from open doorways like the surf, and neon and liquid crystal dazzled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.